I think this is class 199 in the Golden Doves. Wow, 199 classes. I don't know how many more are to go, but we're getting closer to the end, and it's actually quite exciting. Page 120. We're talking about semiotic reading versus semantic reading. Accordingly, there are two classes of reading. Semiotic reading is passive and serves to unveil the meaning of the text as intended by the author. So when you talk about semiotic reading, you look up words as symbols. The words have a specific meaning, and basically this meaning conveys the mind of the author, and the job of the reader is just to basically discover the mind of the author, so to speak, to travel to the mind of the author. That's semiotic reading. In Borges, says, I love Jorge Luis Borges. My father loved Jorge Luis Borges. He's a great author. Many of his stories are just brilliant. So in Borges is Pierre Menard, author of the Quixote, the reader. So let me just explain to you what that story is about. So there's a guy called, I think, Pierre Menard, and he wants to, he wants to write Don Quixote, the story Don Quixote of Cervantes, which was originally written by Cervantes. And as I recall, in order to write that story, he needs to become Cervantes, right? So he wants to rewrite the story as Cervantes wrote it, and it becomes an absurdity. So the reader is expected to penetrate thoroughly the mind and language of the author. The problem is that the words that Cervantes used centuries before Pierre Menard have a slightly different meaning, right? Language is like a river, and it's always flowing. And the relative meaning of ideas changes and the context changes. So you can never penetrate the mind of the author because language is dynamic. But that's what he tries to do. So the reader is expected to penetrate thoroughly the mind and language of the author as the Malach teaching the Israelites according to the Yohanan. And that's the Tzitzit of Yohanan, which is semiotic reading. And it's a particular approach. It's a particular concept. Somehow the reader must become the author and rewrite the text he is reading with all the ensuing paradoxes that Borges so subtly insinuated. So that's in footnote 20. Yeah. All right. In semantic reading, every text is like a volume of Borges's The Library of Babel. That's a great, one of my favorite stories is The Library of Babel. The library includes all possible books in all possible languages. So it has every single book. It has a book that supports the Trinity. It has a book that refutes the Trinity. It has a book that refutes the refutation of the Trinity. It has every single book possible in every single language, every single combination of letters possible. A volume. Any volume represents a single variant out of all the possible variants of any possible text, right? Reading, therefore, involves a crisis of choice. So anytime you read, this is what Shlomo HaMelech meant when he wrote, Asot Sefarim Harbeh En Kes Ve'Lahag Harbeh Iriat Basar. So there's always going to be a crisis of choice when you read. You're always going to have to put words together and try to formulate an interpretation of the text. And that interpretation is not going to be identical to the author because your usage of language is going to be a little different than the author's usage of language and so on. Culture changes, ideas change, perspectives change. The choice must be exclusive. It's exclusive to that reader. Interpretation must process the multiple meanings and transform them into a single significant text. Therefore, semantic reading excludes intertextuality. A book, any book, must be like the book. So, what is meant here by intertextuality? Let me see. The concept of intertextuality. I think what he means is that each book has to be approached as a single unit, right? Intertextuality. Okay, so intertextuality in Europe is the shaping of a text's meaning by another text, either through deliberate compositional strategies such as quotation, allusion, plagiarism, translation. So let's give an example of intertextuality. So it's, so my sense was correct. So the mention of Long John Silver and Peter Pan is actually an intertextual allusion to Treasure Island, right? So now the problem with intertextuality is that then the reader has numberless ways in which he can decipher the meaning of a text. Because you always say, oh, he used this word, referring to that book, referring to that, referring to this. So then that's how it becomes a library of Babel. Therefore, so semantic reading excludes intertextuality. A book, any book, must be like the book. Let me explain something. My father, people used to think that my father is against Rashi. Chas v'shalom, he's not against Rashi. What my father, it has to do with intertextuality, is that in the case of intertextuality, you can use an external book to displace a book. So for example, in the case of Rashi, they were using Rashi, the way he was being used by teachers, to displace the Peshat of the text. Meaning, rather than approaching the text in many schools, what does this pasuk mean? Rashi says, is always the answer. So the correct answer is, what does a pasuk mean? Well, let me read the pasuk, let me try to understand it, let me grapple with the words. Doesn't mean I can't use Rashi, or I can't use Ibn Ezra, or I can't use Ankelos, or Ibn Sadegon, to try to understand the pasuk. But I need to read the pasuk. I need to process it in my mind, right? So I just wanted to make that clarification about the misuse of Rashi by the yeshiva world public assumes intertextuality as a valid criterion through which to interpret writing. So that's semantic reading. As mentioned earlier, Eupolemus maintained that the Bible was the first book ever written. What does it mean when he says that the Bible was the first book ever written? Is that correct? For example, one second, please. So to be clear, Eupolemus was a Greek historian, a Jewish historian, right? 13th century BCE, does that make sense? How can that be 13th century BCE? Well, that's a pretty old interpretation. So I'm going to read to you what it says here. First significant Greco-Jewish historian. His name, the time when he lived, and the content of the remaining fragments of his work combined to make it likely that he's identical with Eupolemus. All right, so no, it's not from the 13th century BC, and I don't know why it was written on the internet that it was. He was apparently from the Greek period or the Hellenistic period. So anyway, Eupolemus maintained that the Bible was the first book ever written. In fact, he believed that writing was first introduced by Moses in the Hebrews. Moses was the first, because the idea of semantic reading, a semantic text that is independent of all other texts, and that is independent of the mind of the author. That's the idea of the first book ever written. There were semiotic texts written beforehand, of course, but that's the point of the first book ever written. This is a quote. Moses was the first wise man and the first that handed down the tradition of writing to the Jews. It was the Jews that the Phoenicians received it. It was from the Jews that the Phoenicians received it, and the Greeks from the Phoenicians. So the Jews are the ones who introduced the concept of writing. Also, Moses was the first who wrote down the laws for the Jews. The Torah is the first book, not simply because the writings of other people were not designed for transmission and therefore are not books, right? Because for idea of transmission, you need to have semantic reading, right? Because semantic reading means every generation has to read the book anew and grapple with the words anew and understand it from their own perspective. And by the way, I just want to say this because I have to explain. I don't want people to be missing. We don't mean the halakha changes. We don't mean that. There are primary laws that we receive from Moshe Rabbeinu. Those primary laws never change. The Terag Mitzvot, I just want to put it out there. We're not here to, but the reading, the understanding, we view things from a unique perspective, always. So that's what makes it the first book in that sense, or the first set of laws, because the set of laws that's given to the people, right? So the Code of Hammurabi, right, for example, it existed before it, but it wasn't a book that was given to the people to be read by the people and interpreted by the people. The Torah is the first book, not simply because the writings of other people were not designed for transmission and therefore are not books, but because any book worth reading must be the first book. That is, it must be free from all other books, a complete rejection of intertextuality. So again, the problem with Rashi, Chas V'Shalom, is not Rashi, God forbid, and it's not his Perush, God forbid. It's the use of his Perush to displace the text. More precisely, like the Torah itself, it must antecede creation. Wow. That's why you have the pasuk in Mishle Adonai Kanani Reshit Darko Kedem Mif'alav Me'az, that the Torah pre-exists. The Torah, the Chumah, is speaking and say, I come before the creations of the world. In contradistinction to the Western tradition, for Judaism, the book does not reflect the universe. The universe must reflect the book. That's amazing. Western literature, through appropriation of the Hebrew scripture, and by using them as a mirror of the universe, appears trapped in a Borgian gallery of distorting mirrors reflecting other mirrors. Right. So again, in Western tradition, the book is a reflection of the universe. So you have the universe exists out there, and then the book is meant to reflect the reality out there, right? For us, that's not correct. For us, the book exists, and it's a universe that, if anything, is a reflection of the book. That's incredible. Adonai Kanani Reshit Darko means when God created the universe, it's a reflection of the book. Wow. Western literature, through appropriation of the Hebrew scriptures and by using them as a mirror of the universe, appears trapped in a Borgian gallery of distorting mirrors and mirrors reflecting other mirrors. So they take this book, which the universe reflects, and they act like, no, this book should be a reflection of the universe. So you have all these contorted mirrors, and for them, they believe in the Bible, but they don't really believe in the Bible. There's an Old Testament, there's a New Testament, there's a No Testament. We don't believe, we do believe, we're Christians, but we have no values. And the Western world has already, for those of you who are not following the news, the Western world has disintegrated. It's in the midst of a civilizational collapse. In Judaism, books on the book are classified as oral law. That's why this Torah she'be'al peh, which is not Torah she'bichtav. That is, so Rashi, or the Midrash Halacha that Rashi quotes, or the Pirushim of Rasag, we have them. But it's a type of Torah she'be'al peh. That is, they are mere surrogates for the phonetic word. Rabbi Yosef ben Megas clearly defined the formal grounds of the distinction between the book and Talmud oral law. The latter is a commentary and therefore is never identical to the true Torah. A commentary cannot displace the text. You must first read the text. The fact that the Talmud may be copied in a parchment with outlines and that, unlike scripture, it does not ritually defile the hands, proves that its status is not the same as that of the Torah. It's not mitameh tayanayim. One of the funniest things I see rabbis in Israel quoting Pesukim. So they bring a pasuk, of Avraham Avinu, with the Shalosham Malachim in Perashat Vayera. They'll say the Gemara in Masechet. I'm just trying to remember where it is. Yeah, the Gemara Masechet Bava Daf Pe Vav Amud Bet. This is real. I'm making this up. It really, that Gemara brings the Shalosham Malachim. So they'll bring the pasuk, and rather than say it's in Perashat Vayera, you have to be shown, right? They'll quote the Gemara. The pasuk appears in the Gemara in Bava Mesiyah Daf Pe Vav Amud Bet. It's a complete joke. I mean, it really is a joke. All right. I don't know what to say. All right. Let's just finish. Let's wrap this up, as they say. This is a quote from Rabbi Yosef Ibn Megas. Shalot Teshuvot Rabbi Yosef Ibn Megas. Wow. Great, great. One of the great, 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 great Chachamim. The Talmud, however, is the explanation, the Ur, and commentary, Pirush, of the Torah, not the true Torah. Don't you see that it does not require lines as does the true Torah, the Torah? You have to Mishnah Tut. You don't write the Gemara. There's no written Gemara. I mean, the Gemara is physically written. It doesn't have the status of a writing, right? It is evident, therefore, that its holiness is inferior to that of the Torah itself. You have a Torah, Chumash, and you have the Gemara. You put the Chumash on top of the Gemara, not the other way around. It does not even come to the holiness of the other holy writings, which defile the hands. All right.